everyone, welcome to a new video. Today I'm going to do my book review and discussion for Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban by J.K. Rowling. In case you don't know, I have decided to reread all the Harry Potter books and do video reviews for all of them and like discussions because, well, as you might know, this is my all-time favorite book series and I love talking about these books. And I fell a little bit behind with these videos. It has been a while since my review of Chamber of Secrets, but now I'm back again. I've read Prisoner of Azkaban and I'm ready to talk about it. So yeah, let's just get started with that. Also, I'm going to put the book down beside me because I'm not going to hold it up the entire video. But yeah, let's just get started. I'm going to talk about Prisoner of Azkaban. So as usual, I will start with a little non-spoiler section and share you some of my non-spoiler thoughts. So Prisoner of Azkaban is definitely the begin point of a change in the Harry Potter series. Book 1 and 2 of Harry Potter are still very simple, still very middle grade, a lot more childlike than the later books in the series, and I think Prisoner of Azkaban definitely is the start of like that transition to a more adult series. And that's something I've always loved about Harry Potter, how the books also grow up, basically sort of with you, or at least with me, because I was growing up as I was reading these books. And actually, Prisoner of Azkaban is the first Harry Potter book that I read partly by myself. The first two books, the first time were read to me by my mother because they were still a bit too difficult for me. But when I was like 7 years old, I decided to read the second half of Prisoner of Azkaban by myself, and I loved it, and now I could finally read as many Harry Potter pages as I wanted. So like, Prisoner of Azkaban is sort of a change within the series, but it is also a change for me personally, so that sort of fits together. So that's why that's always sort of the book for me that sometimes I thought about like really starting the Harry Potter series, even though the first two books are also amazing. But I still think Prisoner of Azkaban is definitely a big step up. I think the writing gets so much better, even though it was already amazing, but it gets even better. The characters get a lot more fleshed out. The books also start getting longer, so you spend more time for a year at Hogwarts with these characters, and that's also something I really love. And also the like ending of Prisoner of Azkaban is, I think, one of my favorite endings of all Harry Potter books. I'm going to talk about it later, like within the discussion, but I love the ending so much. The first time I read it, I was like blown away. I was massively impressed, and yeah, I still love it as to this day. I would say my favorite ending of a Harry Potter book is Goblet of Fire, because that's my favorite Harry Potter book, but this is, I think, the second best sort of like ending where everything becomes clear. Really love it, really enjoy it, and even though like all those years later, I still feel so happy when I read that part. And yeah, it's just, I love Prisoner of Azkaban. I think it's in like my top three favorite Harry Potter books. So yeah, that's all I can say about it for like the spoiler-free stuff. Now I really want to get into details with spoilers, things that I have noticed with this reread. So if you have not read Prisoner of Azkaban yet, you should probably click away if you don't want to get spoiled. I really recommend reading this book first because this book is amazing on a first read. And yeah, then hopefully I will see you later. But if you have read Prisoner of Azkaban, please stay, and yeah, please let me know what you think of all these things. And as always, the things might be a bit random, like I have different notes and different things that I've noticed. There might not be a very logical build up in this, but yeah, please bear with me. Hopefully you enjoy it. And now I'm really going to talk spoilers, so you're warned. So the first thing that I want to talk about, that is something that I really noticed this time, is that the permission slip to go to Hogsmeade, like this year the students can go to Hogsmeade, which is a nearby village, but you need a permission slip from your guardian or your parents to be allowed to do so. And like, it's ridiculous that that is actually a thing. Like, these students go to a magic school where it's pretty much super dangerous every year. Like, only 1 year before this book, students were getting petrified and it was like really dangerous, and like there's always all this stuff going on this school, but then you need a permission slip from your parents to go to the nearby village, which is basically like a super safe village, which isn't even that far from the school. And I know it's mostly because of like the plot device with Harry not having his permission slip and having to sneak out to Hogsmeade. I know that it also like has a function within the plot, but still, if you think about it, it's like ridiculous that that is something they need a permission slip for, but they can do all this dangerous stuff. Like, playing Quidditch is much more dangerous than going to Hogsmeade, but that is something everyone can play apparently without any permission. I know this is sort of nitpicking, I know sometimes things don't really make sense, but it has to be this way for the plot, but still, it's just so funny that this is something that the school is really strict about, and then all this dangerous stuff is going on and they don't care, and like, that's just funny. Like, I love the logic of Hogwarts. Then of course, the opening of this book, Harry doesn't get his permission slip, and he blows up his aunt Margot, and like, she blows up and she flies away. And what I thought was super cute this time around is that Harry then just like walks away and he just decides to live the life of a fugitive. I feel like, again, that is such a cute, like, children's way of thinking. Like, I messed up this one time, I have to go on the run, I'm a fugitive from now on, maybe have to go to prison, I'm going to like look after myself and go on the run. And that's just so cute. And that is of course also why he doesn't manage to do so for like 10 minutes, and then he already gets picked up with like the night bus, and then like of course he goes to Diagon Alley, and then yeah, of course the Minister of Magic, and of course there's like, they're very concerned about him because of Sirius Black. But I think it's so cute that he's like seriously convinced that he has to be a fugitive now and that he has to go to prison and everything because of this mistake. But to be honest, like, he did get a very serious letter last year about magic, which he didn't even perform. So yeah, I can understand that. But I love things like this because it really shows that Harry is only 13 years old. Like, he's still a child. In some things, they're very naive, and that's just something I really love reading about. But yeah, of course, they all go back to Hogwarts as usual. Harry doesn't become a fugitive. They go back, but the big thing in this book is that Sirius Black has escaped, and that people think that he's after Harry. Of course, if you know the book, if you know the entire series, you know that Sirius Black is not like evil and not like a supporter of Voldemort. But yeah, like, the first time around I didn't know that, and that was something like that completely shocked me. Like, he isn't a bad guy, whoa, this is amazing. But now I can't really read about it, like everyone being scared. And you know he isn't a bad guy, you know you love Sirius from later books. But yeah, it's just, I loved it the first time around, and that is something that I really love about first time reads. And I really wish I could read this book again for the first time. And I'm curious to see if I read it for the first time nowadays, if I would notice, if I would like pick up on the clues that Sirius is actually a good guy. And yeah, I don't know, there's really no way I can tell. 7-year-old Michelle didn't have a single clue, but yeah, I wasn't that old, so. But I loved the reading experience of that. But throughout the book, everyone is really scared and really concerned for Harry. Like, there are of course the Dementors, and the Dementors are like one of the scariest things in the entire Harry Potter series. So like, J.K. Rowling based the Dementors on depression. They're basically like a monster form of depression, and I can definitely understand that, and I love that. And like, they're just so creepy and scary, even in book form. I also hated them the first time I saw them on film. Of course, not now anymore, because the effects aren't really that great. But the first time I saw them in the film, I was scared of them. And yeah, I think that's a really good, like, really realistic, scary addition. One thing that doesn't really make sense, though, to me, is Harry is like more sensitive to the Dementors, and then later on Professor Lupin explains that is because he has been through more traumatic events, so he has more to be truly scared about. Like, his bad memories are actually a lot more scary than of his fellow students, which doesn't really make sense to me, because like, is Harry really the only one who has been through something traumatic? Because it's presented as this really special thing that he can't stand the mentors, that he really passes out, and that he's the only one probably in the entire school who has this problem. But like, guys, Ginny Weasley went to trauma like 1 year before. How doesn't it affect her the same way? And I guess you can argue that Ginny doesn't really remember all the things she did when she was possessed by Voldemort. And maybe that's why she isn't scared by any memories, because she doesn't have them. But like still, Harry was only a baby when he went through his traumatic experiences. So you could argue that he doesn't remember them really either. So why doesn't Ginny either? Like this is just something like Ginny went through something really traumatic. And this is something that just gets completely forgotten in later books. Like of course I just finished reading Chamber of Secrets before this. And Ginny was very scared. She was pale. She felt sick. She was worried. Even though she didn't remember actually doing the things when she was possessed, but still, like, why does it affect her? Like, just for an example. And then apart from that, there might be more students in the school who have been through something traumatic. So, you know, I don't really understand how Harry is the only special one in this case, but of course he's the main character, so he's always the special one. Again, I can understand it from a plot point of view, but it doesn't really make sense. I think Harry shouldn't be the only one that is so affected by it. And while we're still on the subject of Dementors, let's talk about Azkaban, which is of course important in this book. It's in the title. Azkaban is basically like torture. People in there get tortured with these Dementors until they go crazy and they only can feel fear and pain. And of course, like, there are people who probably deserve that, but also there are people who maybe not deserve that, so that's a pretty flawed justice system. I mean, in Chamber of Secrets, Hagrid was sent to Azkaban, like, only for show because he was accused of opening the Chamber of Secrets the last time. So he was sent to Azkaban only because the Ministry wanted to do something. And that's really not okay, because being in Azkaban, even for 2 months, is horrible. So, like, I can understand that there's this wizard prison with like Dementors, but why isn't there also a prison that is more like for people who aren't completely convicted yet, or people who have committed a crime but not a very serious crime? Like, why does everyone has to go to Azkaban? Because like that's a pretty severe punishment to be like tortured for your entire life, sucked all the happiness out of you. That's pretty intense. But yeah, I guess with like really bad wizards, it's a good punishment. But yeah, that's just again something that I noticed this time around. I really noticed that now that I'm older, I'm a lot more nitpicking and like looking if things are logical or make sense, and they don't always do, because this is a book about a magic school with wizards, and sometimes the plot has to work, but still. Then on to the next thing. What really sort of was like the theme for me whilst reading Prisoner of Azkaban this time around is that I felt really bad for Hermione. Like, poor Hermione. In this book, she basically almost gets a burnout. She works way too hard. She has the time turner, so she can follow multiple lessons at the same time. She doesn't do anything else besides work. She has a really tough time. And then Ron and Harry start ignoring her because they're angry with her because of a broomstick. Like, that is so mean, actually. Like, Ron and Harry can be assholes in this regard, because especially like Harry gets a really expensive broomstick, like the Firebolt, on his birthday, or was it like Christmas? No, it was with Christmas. And there's no tag attached to it, and like Harry and Ron like, oh, that sounds legit, that's fine, let's just roll with this. No, a very expensive gift with no card, I'm sure it's fine. So like that Hermione wanted to be sure that it wasn't dangerous is actually a really logical thing, and they get so angry about it with her. And of course also with the whole thing with Scabbers, but that was a bit more nuanced because it really did seem like Crookshanks had it out for Scabbers and Hermione didn't do anything about it. So that was something like that was more on both sides. But with like the Firebolt, it's just so mean. They get so angry at her for a stupid Firebolt. Like, I get that it's a very expensive and cool one, but you have to admit that if you get a very expensive thing out of nowhere, that you maybe have to check it out, especially if you think there's a murderer who has it out for you. Then Hermione has a really rough time. She feels alone, she's busy. I just felt so much for her, and like she took way too much on her plate. And like with the time turner, it's not really like something a school should do actually, you know, give a student a way of means to do even more, especially when that girl's just 13 years old. And I love that she does learn her lesson at the end of the book and starts doing less work. And yeah, I just felt for her, because Ron and Harry could be very mean to her, and she wants the best for everyone. She's a genuinely sweet person. She does everything as good as she can, and yeah, I just really felt for her. I will admit that, of course, Hermione is a bit of a know-it-all. That's just something about her. And I will also admit that she doesn't really have that she isn't always very tactful when it comes to proving her right. For example, with Lavender Brown, and then like her rabbit dies, and then Lavender Brown is like, Professor Trelawney predicted this, and Hermione is like, no, but it's a coincidence. You don't even know if he died today or like last week. That is something that I'm like, Hermione, I know you want to prove you're right, but maybe just hold back this time when someone is really sad. And that is something she doesn't really know how to do. She really wants to like be right all the time, and I think that's one of her major flaws. But apart from that, Hermione is such a sweet girl. She looks out for everyone. Like, she's the only one in the trio with a bit of sense, I guess. Like, she's the brains of the group, and I love her so much, and I really felt sorry for her. She really has a rough time in this book. But okay, so much to talk about. Next, of course, again back to the Sirius Black plot point. Harry overhears a conversation between, I don't know, Hagrid, Professor McGonagall, Fudge, like talking about how Sirius supposedly betrayed his parents and caused their deaths. First of all, very convenient that they have this conversation in like a public room with everyone to overhear. In the movie, they do a better job of that because Harry actually has to follow them to a secret room with like his invisibility cloak. So that is done better in the movie. But anyway, again, something that is not really important if you think about it. But yeah, Harry, of course, gets really angry. He wants to take revenge out on Sirius. And then at the end of the book, when they are in the shrieking shack with Sirius and then Ron, Hermione, and Harry, and he's really upset. And like, one thing, Sirius doesn't really do a good job of telling Harry that he's innocent. Like, he's very cryptic, and he just says like these evil, like things that can be interpreted as evil. Like, there's only going to be one murder tonight, and maybe you should tell this very scared kid that you're not going to murder him, but you want to murder the rat. Again, it works for suspense, but you know, if he's really innocent, I mean, he is really innocent, maybe tell so to these scared 13-year-old kids, because there's no reason to like not do so, even though he's very angry and everything. But yeah. And then of course, for the ending that I love so much, Ron's Red Scabbers is Peter Pettigrew, and he's the one who portrayed Harry's parents. Remus Lupin is a werewolf, Sirius Black is innocent, everything goes down in the shrieking shack, and just that like scene gets me every time. I love it so much. I was, again, as I said before, shocked when I first read it. I was blown away. I loved it. Yeah, I think that's one of the best sequences in the entire Harry Potter series. I love how there are actually clues. If you reread it, you can see sort of like clues that Peter Pettigrew isn't like a normal rat. And yeah, it's also a bit weird to think that he was like a rat within Harry's room for these past 2 years, or past 3 years. But I love the reveal. I love it every time around. I think it's so, so good. And that's just something like why I love Harry Potter so much, because it's basically all these mysteries and you get surprised each time around. I love it. I love reading about it. And yeah, I think that is like, this ending is why I love this book already so much more than the first two. Again, I still really love the first two books, but this is such a step up with this like fantastic twist ending. And yeah, I cannot express enough love for it. I'm just so fond of that ending. And then the last thing I want to talk about is, of course, that this book has time travel with like the time turner, and Harry and Hermione go back in time to save Buckbeak and save Sirius. And lots of people have talked about it, like time travel, it's very complicated, it creates plot holes. Why don't they use the time turner every time there's a problem? J.K. Rowling has sort of tried to fix this with already explaining within the book how dangerous time travel is and how you can't really do it for everything. And also later on in the series, it's not really, I'm not going to say how, but time turners get destroyed. So for me, nowadays when I reread it, I try not to question it too much or think about it too much, because like, if you do, it's complicated. Time travel is always complicated, it always creates problems. But I also, again, love that sort of twist and how we went back. You think you're at the ending, but then actually you're not at the ending. There's this whole scene where they go back and change everything, or also don't really change everything because apparently everything was already supposed to happen that way. I don't know, again, let's not talk about it, it's so complicated. But I am happy that they only use time travel in this book because otherwise it would be too weird and yeah, it's just... It's something you don't have to think about too much because it will make you crazy. So yeah, this is it now for my review and discussion of Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban. Again, it was a bit random and there's probably stuff that I've missed talking about. Like, I try to make notes, but sometimes I sort of forget something. I'm sorry. But yeah, as always, please let me know down in the comments what you think of this book, what you think of some of the things that I've said. I would love to discuss all these points with you because I love discussing Harry Potter. I love it so much. And I am going to continue with this review series. I'm going to read all the books and I'm going to reviews for all of them. I can't promise when all those videos will be up, but it is going to happen. So don't worry, your favorite book will be talked about. But yeah, this is it now for this video. And if you like this video, please go subscribe or maybe give it a thumbs up because I would really appreciate that. And then hopefully I will see you again very soon in my next video. Bye!